yells if I can hear.
Thank you.
My soul.
want to read from Romans chapter 6 this morning. Now if we died with Christ, we believe that we will also live with him. For we know that since Christ was raised from the dead, he cannot die again. Death no longer has mastery over him. The death he died to sin once for all. But the life he lives to God. Now in the same way, count yourselves dead to sin, but alive to God in Jesus Christ. Therefore, do not let sin reign in your mortal body, so that you obey its evil desires. Do not offer any part of yourself to sin as an instrument of wickedness, but rather offer yourselves to God as those who have been brought from death to life, and offer every part of yourself to him as an instrument of righteousness. For sin shall no longer be your master, because you are not under the law, but under grace. What then? Shall we sin because we are not under the law, but under grace? By no means. Don't you know that when you offer yourselves to someone as obedient slaves, you are slaves to that one you obey? Whether you are slaves to sin, which leads to death, or to obedience, which leads to righteousness. But thanks be to God that though you used to be slaves to sin, you have come to obey from your heart the pattern of teaching that has now claimed your allegiance. You have been set free from sin and have become slaves to righteousness. As we come to him this morning, set free from sin, let's pledge our allegiance to the one who died for us and give him our heart and our life today.
Here's my heart, Lord. Here's my
Here's my Our lives. lives as that time approaches. Hebrews tells us that we should be meeting together even more as the day approaches. But we should be doing more than just meeting together. We should be looking more like Jesus. Join me in verse 7. 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 7. Now the end of all things is near. Whether it's the physical death or the getting caught up. The end of all things is near. Therefore, be serious and disciplined for prayer. Above all, maintain an intense love for each other, since love covers a multitude of sins. Be hospitable to one another without complaining. Based on the gift each one has received, use it to serve others as good managers of the varied grace of God. If anyone speaks, it should be as one who speaks God's words. If anyone serves, it should be from the strength God provides, so that God may be glorified through Jesus Christ in everything. To Him be the glory and the power forever. Amen. What's amen mean? So be it. So be it. Yeah, I don't know how old I was when I finally figured that out. You know, you always hear amen in church. And we don't ever teach our young people. You know, our young people don't speak King James English. They barely speak our English. They got their own language out there that has more to do with computers and shortcuts than anything else. They're worse than the government with initials. I mean, they got their own language. They didn't know what amen means. It means so be it. It's as you have spoken, I am in agreement with you. So if you ever amen the preacher, but you're in disagreement, you shouldn't be amen the preacher. I don't have to worry about that here, do I?
No.
But we're working on it. We're going to get there. He gives us some advice here that we need to take note of. As he comes to the end of his writing, we'll end in chapter 5. We've got a few more weeks of 1 Peter. He says, as the end approaches, therefore. The therefore simply this time is referring to the as the end approaches. As we prepare our lives for the return of Christ, or the meeting up with Christ, or the dying and going to be with Christ, therefore as the end approaches, he's not talking about the end of all things necessarily, like nuclear war, of course he wouldn't have known that, but he's not talking about that. He's talking about as we approach our time of meeting Jesus face to face. That's what he's talking about here. As we prepare ourselves to meet Jesus face to face, the very first thing he tells us is be serious about prayer. Now, how many of you pray every day? Raise your hands. Got some of you ready to respond. Don't raise your hand. How many of you pray every day? How many of you pray multiple times a day? How many of you have a prayer closet? How many of you have a set aside time of prayer? How many of you go through your directory or your Sunday school class or your family needs or have a prayer journal? Be serious about prayer. This has been a struggle for you through my life. I'm kind of haphazard about prayer. Anybody with me? You can raise your hand on that one and admit sin. I believe it's sinful to be haphazard. It's not wrong, necessarily, because you're still praying. But what God has called us to is the seriousness of prayer. Be serious about prayer. Attitude, timing, focus. It's not talking about longevity here. I mean, let me clear that one up. I had a buddy at one point who talked about being in his prayer closet for 4 hours and wishing he had more time. Praise be to Jesus, but how did he cook something? You know? How did he get his work done? How did he get his sermons prepared? He was talking about daily. He wasn't talking about once a week or once in a while. I'm not knocking it. If that worked for him, so be it. Because we're going to be serious about prayer. And he was serious about prayer. He was a warrior on his knees. If I had a need at that point in my life, he's the one I was going to. Why? Because he was on his knees. Hours and hours with the Lord. And I don't mind my name being in the Lord's ears ringing by God's people are praying for me. That's a good thing. I want to be prayed for. He tells us we need to be serious about prayer. We need to be serious about praying for others. We need to be serious about praying for the Lord's will to be done. We need to be serious about praying for ourselves and our families. We need to be following the model that Jesus gave of prayer. Our daily needs. The bottom line is we need to be serious about prayer. What should we pray about? Everything. In all things, in prayer and petitions, right? We should be going before the Lord. We should be seeking. times, and not just in good times, but in all times, as the end approaches or as it draws near, we should be serious about prayer. We don't pray well, I don't think, as a whole. Some people may pray well individually, but as a whole, we don't pray well. I've been asked over and over again over the years, why do we spend so much time on prayer requests and praises? You know, I admit I'm not the best private prayer. I struggle with having that set-aside time, that closet time. It varies through the day. It's not like some of you who are at like 4:45 in the morning, I'm on my knees, and at 4:59 I'm getting up. And I don't work that way. But I try to have time with God every day. And I try to have powerful time with God every day. And I want to have serious time with God every day. I want to pray about all those things. But I don't think we do that well. It's why we have those pastoral prayer times where we share prayer requests and praise reports, because we want to do publicly what we're doing privately. We want to show the necessity and the need that we're willing to take out of that hour and a half y'all give me to prepare a worship service, that we're going to spend 10 minutes of that in prayer. Quite frankly, that maybe isn't enough in reality. I know it's enough for all of you because you're like, come on, preacher, hurry up. We want to get to the scene. But maybe it's really not enough. What did the disciples do over and over again in their lives? They gathered together for what? Praying and singing of hymns. What did Jesus do at the Last Supper? Fellowshipped and worshipped. They sang hymns. They went to the garden and he prayed with his disciples. The three taken off to the side for additional prayer. What did he do? As John the Baptist was about to be beheaded, he'd been busy teaching all day long. He sought a quiet place to pray. Throughout his ministry, what's he doing? He's teaching us. We're not refreshed with the food, and we're not refreshed with the sleep. We're refreshed with the Spirit of God, that connection through prayer. We've got to be praying people. We've got to be serious about prayer. And as the day approaches, what's he tell us to do? He tells us to pray. In Acts chapter 2, as the church is exploding and being founded and grounded, they're in the book of Acts. They're in Jerusalem. One of the five things he tells them to do is to pray. They're praying together. We've got to be a praying people if we're going to honor God, if we're going to make it through this life, if people are going to see us the way we want to be seen, if when we're in the box, our life is going to speak the right things. It starts with a prayer foundation, a prayer connection. See this? Now, because the end is near, be disciplined and serious in prayer. That discipline part is the hard part for me. The serious, I think I understand, but the discipline's difficult. It's something I got to improve on. Have a routine in a positive way. Have it as the unmovable part of my day. Everything's flexible, right? But let's make sure prayer structured for time with God. That's the piece we don't give up. Let's give up something else. Let's don't give up our connection to our Father. He goes on because prayer is not the only thing we need to be about. He says above all. He says above prayer. I don't think he's characterizing these hierarchically. That's not a word. In order of importance. I think he's saying these things are great. Pray like you've never prayed before. And he says above all, put this one up there with it. Now, if he's saying this one's above all, this is the top, that's okay too. Because that is something we should be doing. These things he's going to tell us are good and they will affect our prayer life. Above all, maintain intense love or absolute love or undying love or unselfish love. There's a lot of adjectives that could have been translated as. But the point here is not the adjective. The point here is the love. Above all, pray, we should be loving. As we serve, we should be loving. As we teach, we should be loving. As we read, we should be loving the Lord and be being loved by the Lord. Love each other, he says. Love doesn't always mean like. You know there's not an equal sign between love and like? There's one of those squiggly lines, actually two of those little squiggly lines. Approximately or about or sometimes. You can love somebody and not like them. Allison and I were having that discussion about marriage and which is more important, to like or to love or to commitment, that whole thing that we do as pastors. I believe commitment. about me, this is about you. You're a lot more likable than I am. But I want to be loved even when I'm not liked. We can love each other, can't we? There are some times that it's just difficult to be in like with someone. But when we're walking with Jesus, it's not difficult to be in love with them. Not romantic love. God's love. If he says above all else, love each other. In love, there's no room for anger. There's no room for wrath. There's no room for judgment. By the way, who is all judgment being given to? To Jesus. My name is not Jesus. My character is not his character, though I hope it's becoming his character. Judgment is given to the Lord. Now, we are told that we should judge one another in our actions in the sense of helping each other to live well, live right, not in the sense of demeaning or defaming or shaming one another. But we do judge one another. He says, how much more should we judge one another since you will judge the angels? We'll be with Christ in heaven. Of course, then we'll be perfect. And because he's perfect and he's made us perfect and he's declared us perfect. So then we have the right in that perfection. Give the judgment. But here in the flesh and our sinfulness, as we're being sanctified, he doesn't say judge, he says love. Love each other. Love also means discipline. Love also means help. Love also means instruct. Love also means come alongside. It means cry with. It means lift up. Love means all of those things that we know it to be. So as we pray, we should be loving one another, and praying is part of loving each other. If you love me, you pray for me. If I love you, I pray for you. If I love the lost, what do I do? Jesus said, I came to seek and to save the lost. It's not the healthy who need a doctor, but the sick. It's by his great love that he stepped out of heaven so that all could be saved. His love, like no other, that he laid down his life for the lost, that they might be saved. We should love each other above all else. Where does love not fit? See, love is one of those overriding absolutes that should be the character nature of every Christian. As we pray, we love. Love, so therefore we pray. Now there's more to this because he doesn't stop there. He says, above all, maintain intense love for each other since love covers a multitude of sins. Let me say, first, love does not forgive sins. Christ's love forgave our sins. Our love does not forgive sins. Our love does not cause our sins to be forgiven. That's all in Christ's hands. But who is it easier to forgive? The one who kicks dirt in your face or the one who puts a band-aid on your cut? Who is it easier to forgive? The one who speaks kind words to you or the one who cusses you out? Who is it easier to forgive? The one who shows love or the one who shows hate or anger or frustration? See, our love is going to cover a multitude of sins from the perspective of other people wanting to be with us, wanting to help us, wanting to walk through life with us. That's what he's talking about here. He's not talking about the power of our love equaling forgiveness. That's not what it's saying. And I've heard it said that as long as you love, that's all that matters. Because the Bible says that love will cover a multitude of sins. Makes it easier for you to be forgiven. Makes it easier for people to want to hang around you. A clean person, it's a whole lot easier to hug than a dirty person. We were out doing the bubble, what was that thing called? The foam party with the kids. And I knew from before I ever got there I was going to get all foamed up, so I dressed appropriately. And I let him play for a little while, but I couldn't handle it very long. I went out and started getting hugged on. Ariel loved to hug me that day, didn't you, Ariel? I was a little reluctant at first, but I was in. It's a whole lot easier, though, to hug a clean person than it is a dirty person. Unless they're covered in foam, then it's kind of fun, right? See, love covers a multitude of sins because people are more willing to connect and forgive. God wants us to want to be like Him. One of the things we're saying, one of the lines, talked about our obedience. obedience doesn't make us righteous, but it shows our righteousness. It's a right response to what God has called us to. So we pray seriously with intensity. We love unconditionally God's way, each other. In verse 9 it says, be hospitable. What does it mean to be hospitable? See, this is a connection to the love aspect. Hospitable means welcoming people in. One of our prayer requests this morning was that we draw people in and the Lord bring people to us. Amen. I'm all for that. But I think alongside that prayer, probably before that prayer, we need to pray, Lord, make us hospitable. Not just at the front door. Not just at the Sunday school door. Not just at the worship service door. Make us hospitable in the parking lot. Before and after church. Make us hospitable at the sink in the bathroom. Make us hospitable in the hallways. Lord, make us hospitable on Monday, so by the time Sunday gets around, we are prepared. We painted a couple of classrooms a week. That's the royal week, right, guys? I painted it because I had nothing to do with it. Painted a couple of classrooms. Why paint a couple of classrooms? So when the kids show up, you know, we're not in them this morning because the paint's still dry, but when the kids show up, they have a nice, clean room. Why do we do that? To be hospitable. To draw them in. To remove a barrier that might would say they won't come back the next week. Parents, you know this good and well. What happens if you take your kids or grandkids to a place to drop them off and the room's a wreck and it's dirty? Unless you've got a long-time relationship with that place, you're not going back with your kids, are you? We got to prepare ourselves to be hospitable ahead of time. You ever throw an extra pork chop in the crock pot? If you're not using the crock pot, you're doing it wrong. Let me just go ahead and tell you that up front. It's biblical. Nice, tender, juicy every time. You ever throw an extra one in there? Just in case the Lord gives you somebody to feed. You ever have that happen? We started cooking yesterday for dinner. Lo and behold, we had five around our table. That wasn't prepared for when the meal started, but as it turned out, there was more food than we thought we were going to have. And we're like, hey, we got more food. Let's invite somebody over. Hospitable. Are you prepared to be hospitable? Now you're all going to say, when did I get my phone call? Talk to Allison about that. She's hospitable. I mean, I'm stubborn. The Lord's got a role on all of us, doesn't he? Prayer, love, hospitality, without complaining. You know when we had five people because Allison invited somebody over because we had more food than we needed? I got to do the dishes. Because that's my job. She cooks, I clean. The dishes. Everything else she does. I don't get too much credit, but I do dishes. Me and the dishwasher. Hospitable without complaining. Oh, you ever invite somebody over and they make a mess? You love the fact that they're there, but you hate the fact that they made the mess. And but you love them anyway. And you show hospitality to them by inviting them back. And you don't complain. And you do it with the joy in your heart of praise Jesus that we had that time together. See, as we love unconditionally, we pray for people, we show hospitality, we begin to look like Jesus. And I'm not going to preach these next three things he gives to us, but he gives illustration of how we're to do this based on our giftedness. Each one has received varied gifts. We're not all the same. We're each gifted individually. Out of our giftedness, we should each do something. He says, if one has received, use it to serve others as good managers. So if your gift is to serve, be a good manager. If anyone speaks, it should be one who speaks God's words. Speak well. He's given examples of how we love, how we pray, how we show hospitality. If anyone serves, it should be from the strength God provides. Why do we make God the center of everything we do through the very gifts we get? So that God may be glorified through Jesus Christ in everything. Therefore, as the end approaches, let's make sure we live our lives in such a way that Jesus Christ gets glory. That it's through Jesus Christ that we do these things. Not in our own strength, not for our own glory, not for our own benefit, but for the glory of God through Jesus Christ. starts with giving our lives to Jesus. Because we can't love others until we've been loved by God. The way we're loved by God is by receiving His Son, Jesus. If you're in Jesus Christ, have you followed Him in obedience? Obedience is not salvation, but it shows a changed heart. It shows an obedient heart. It shows a love for our Father. Have you followed in obedience of baptism? Have you followed in obedience of service? Have you followed in obedience of sanctification as you pray, as you read scriptures, as you grow in your local church, as you serve in your community? All for the glory of Christ. For it's all His. Do you know Jesus? Do you serve Jesus? Is there room for improvement? He gave us the top three here. He didn't make it real difficult. Most of us can handle three. Pray, love, be hospitable, inviting to others. Let's work on those this week. Let's respond to God now as He calls us. We pray for Him. And then we have our time of response and invitation. Father, we love You. We thank You for the simplicity of the message, but the high importance of this call. For there is nothing more important than knowing You, first and foremost. That while we were yet sinners, You loved us. You died for us. And You have said that for all who call upon Your name, they will be saved. So You saved us. Father, we are thankful for salvation that comes in Christ Jesus. So this morning we come saying, for those who have never made that commitment, for those who are lost, for those who are still living in their sin, the Lord loves you. And He wants you to be His child. And He wants to transform you and give you new life. And He wants to give you value and opportunity. And He wants to develop you into the person He designed you to be. The question is, will you let Him? Will you say, I'm a sinner? Lord, forgive me for my sins. I believe in Jesus. He's Your Son. He died for me. And I choose to live my life for Him. Will you follow Him in obedience? Being transformed and living out love and prayer and hospitality and the other things the Scriptures do teach us as well. Learning new every day. Desiring to serve every day. Those of you who know Jesus, are you willing to make that commitment as well? That I will pray, that I will love, that I will show hospitality, that I will be better tomorrow than I was today, and I'll be better today than I was yesterday. As I seek to learn to live like Jesus, as I seek to learn to love others, even the unlovable, maybe we need to say, Lord, forgive me and restore me to righteousness. Maybe we need to say, Lord, use me. Here I am, send me. But maybe we need to say, Lord, here is my heart. It is Yours. Show me what is next. Lord, as we just humble ourselves before You, speak to us. Give us the courage to respond. We ask this in Jesus' name. Can you stand with me? As we stand, if you need to respond for some reason, salvation, baptism, membership, if you need to pray at the altars, if you just need to come and be prayed over, be prayed with, won't you come? Give your heart fresh and new to Jesus. Once for salvation, but daily in obedience. Here's my heart.
Here's my heart.
It's fine.
Zion.